I would like to present the next keynote lecture, Professor Kenji Ishihara from Japan. Kenji graduated from Civil Engineer Department, University of Tokyo. He is now Professor of Chuo University, Tokyo, Emeritus Professor, University of Tokyo. Professor Ishihara was the President of International Society of Soil Mechanics and Geotechnical Engineering from 1997 to 2001. He devoted whole life for very wide variety of areas, especially geotechnics associated with the earthquake and natural disaster.
Your kind introduction, Dr. Long, who is the organizer of this conference. I'm very much honored to be here in front of you and to give an opportunity to address issues of current importance, particularly in Japan, associated with the tremendous disaster due to tsunami invasion and also consequent geotechnical damage. Since this issue has been widely reported worldwide by mass media, there is no need for me to repeat the general features of the damage. I want to address the issues of geotechnical importance in this opportunity. Before I start my presentation, I was asked by the president of the International Society of Soil Mechanics and Geotechnical Engineering to give you the best regards and also the success congratulations to organize such a interesting and memorable conference. Professor John Luis Burio is now acting as the president of International Society. He was keen to come here. However, because of the council meeting which was held a week ago, he is unable to show up. The secondary, the president of the Japanese Geotechnical Society, Dr. Kusakabe, also requested to me to give you his best regard and successful conference on behalf of the Japanese Geotechnical Society. These are the message I have to write, I have to give to you at the beginning. Coming to the main topics of my presentation, I changed a little bit the title of my presentation as written in this here. I want to touch on tsunami-induced damage to some extent. Although the investigation is still going on, I cannot tell the detail of the damage features, but I hope I'll be able to address the main point of geotechnical importance. Sendai, in the northern part of Japan, the event of the earthquakes was a magnitude 9.0, as you might know, and that is the largest magnitude event we encountered in Japan since the observation of earthquake started about 130 years ago. This is a typical time history of acceleration recorded at Sendai, nearest to the epicenters, where you can see there are two events taking place one after another with a maximum acceleration exceeding 1,000 Gauss. The trajectory of the motions of acceleration plotted in the axis of EW and NS direction. As you can see, the motion is predominant in the, the spectral response observation, talking about galaxies against the period in the second, and this kind of things are not so familiar with technical engineers, so I'm going to skip the detailed account of the meaning of the spectral observation. This is a recorded motion at Urayasu in Tokyo Bay area, indicating the maximum acceleration on an order of 160 regards in the east direction. In the east direction, this is also the spectral response acceleration obtained from the analysis of motions recorded at Urayasu in Tokyo Bay. The effect of earthquake spread downwards, southwards to the area of Tokyo Bay and also the lower beach of the very long river, which is called Tonnel River. Liquefaction developed extensively in these areas as well as the reclaimed area surrounding Tokyo Bay. This is an enlarged map of Tokyo Bay indicating the particularly devastated areas due to liquefaction. An enlarged map shown here indicates special area of damage due to liquefaction. I would like to concentrate on the damaged features in this reclaimed land, which is called Urayasu City, as well as some part of the areas belonging to the Chiba prefectures. Areas encrossed by this dotted line suffered tremendous damage. There are several residential areas around here. So in total, 75,000 houses suffered some amount of settlement and tilt. The tilt, even a small amount of tilt, say 0.5%, that is 1 meter, no, 10 meters, 5 centimeter tilt. Looks like this, typically, showing the a kind of interaction between foundation and surrounding soils. And also, this building is supported by piles, whereas this entrance is just sitting on liquefiable materials outside, so there was about 50 centimeter vertical offset that develop as a result of settlement. Typical distress is described in these pictures. There are lifelines buried at a depth of about 2 meters from the ground surface, and the most serious was the damage of the sewage discharge line. Because of the corroding of liquefied material into of this sewage line, people cannot use the waters in the house, so they have to evacuate for to find out another place to dig. This is the typical distress incurred by local people. I'd like to talk about somewhat lateral deformation which takes place in this zone. Looking Martin from the Virginia Tech, where you can see this the spreading. This is the view toward the east, where you can see the collapse of the sea wall in front of the about 30 meters entrance, which is retained by the sea wall behind. This is the features of the sun spreading which had developed in front of the seawall, but in the back of the brick water block statue. This spread, the damage of this in this area is schematically or conceptually described in this map. There is the cemetery park, there is a seawall, and also this is a ceasefire supported brick waters, blocks. There was a liquefaction which had developed along this line, inducing the lateral flow as illustrated in this diagram. I would like to introduce another features of the damage in Chiba areas, a little bit east of Urayasu. I'm going to talk about the settlement of the ground near the entrance to the parking area of baseball stadium, which is Marina Stadium. This is the well-known river, which is called Hanami River. This is a picture showing the vertical offset which developed in this parking park, traffic park areas. This is a vertical offset between the houses and also the surrounding soil, showing about 50 centimeter relative displacement due probably to the interaction between foundation and surrounding soils. The conceptual diagram of this large scale lateral flow is described here. This is the park areas. There was the bushes, and there is a walkway about 1 or 2 meters below this elevation, and further on, this is the riverbed elevation. And this picture shows how a very simple analysis was conducted to provide the first-hand interpretation for the settlement of the ground, which took place in the level ground, using this chart, which expressed the factor of safety against liquefaction in terms of the post-liquefaction volumetric strain. For example, I'm going to show you two examples of liquefaction damage site, and also two examples where there was no evidence of liquefaction. So this is one of the results of analysis, drawing attention to this particular place in Urayasu. The results of analysis is shown here. This is SPTN values. The light colored soil profile indicates the original N values, and the thick black curve indicates N1 values normalized to an effective compounding stress of 1 kilogram per cubic centimeter, as you might know. This is a factor of safety against liquefaction, protein versus depth, and this is the volumetric strain. If we integrate the volumetric strain, is about 40 centimeters ground settlement estimated on the basis of the simple analysis. Another example of the ground settlement was made at this place, that is Isobe town, south of Hanami River. Results of analysis show the maximum settlement on the order of 40 centimeters. The non-liquefied site, which is located in old town part of Urayasu, show the settlement distribution as shown here, coming up with a value of 20 centimeters. Although there was no evidence, no apparent signs of liquefaction visible on the ground surface, the calculated values show a 20 centimeter settlement, which is different, which appears to be but incorrect evaluation of settlement assessment. This is another example of the analysis conducted at this place where there was no surface evidence of liquefaction at the time of the earthquake. Now, the results of analysis is shown here, coming up with a value of 20 centimeters. Now, all these data are plotted in this diagram in terms of estimated settlement data are plotted in this area, indicating relatively good agreement between estimated and observed values. However, in the all town areas enclosed by this line, the estimated settlement was amounted. Tsunami have been publicized very widely by news media. So I don't want to touch on this subject, but I just want to introduce two cases of damage and two cases only of no damage. One is occurred in 20 Kamaishi City, Yuji prefectures. The location is indicated here. This is the northern part of Japan, which suffers tremendous distress due to the tsunami effect. The place, exact place of collapse of sea walls at Toni is located here. This is the image taken from the Google Earth, indicating the sea walls extending from the south to this location, where you can see the collapse of the sea wall here. There are about 100 houses on the steep slopes, so everybody evacuated. Nobody was killed at this in this instance. This is a large map of the tsunami devastated sea wall. So this is the front view of the banks, indicating the banks of the sea wall, which was destroyed, particularly in this portion where there is an entrance between the fishery port and the housing or industrial areas behind the sea wall. Looking from the north, that is, we are looking from here, the situation of the tsunami protecting a sea wall looks like this. You can see the very many houses sitting on the steep slope. And then, now we are looking from the south to the collapsed places. This is the seaport in front of the sea wall, which was recovered to some extent when we paid a visit to this site. This is overturning of the Shun sea wall. It's about 12.5 meters high. And this is another view of the overturning of sea wall consisting of a concrete rock.
The chairman of organization's committee. I would like to say sorry because we should have coffee.